So is my clock fast then?
No. It's your one. It's 5:15.
So is the live stream started or is he not starting up yet?
It seems dark in here. Does it seem dark to you?
She closed the blinds.
Oh, that's right. You closed up the blinds. That's probably why. All right. Thank you all for being here. Please take your gray songbook, stand and turn page number 753. Page number 753, I am resolved. Page number 753. Jesus saves. Page number 621. Jesus saves.
We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Spread the word. It's all around. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Bear the news to everywhere. Climb the streets and cross the waves. Offer to Jesus saves.
us in prayer this evening, please.
Father, I am thankful that Jesus triumphed over the tomb. Thankful that that he made a way for me to do the same. And God, I pray that if there's anybody here this evening that hasn't experienced that victory over death, sin, and condemnation, God, that today would be the day of salvation and that they get born again. Even today, as they hear the word preached, I pray that you'd help. The delivery of the message, I pray that you'd help us to all have readiness of mind to receive the word. And I'm just grateful for the day that we've had so far. We're still praying, of course, for Miss Denise and for Brother Nate, God, that you'd be with them as they recover, God. Just help facilitate the healing process there. Give the doctors continued wisdom in that and be with the families. Give them strength to endure this trial. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's go ahead and shake hands. Pastor's gone. I put forward a motion to get one of those flat escalator things that they have in the mall so I can get from there to here quicker, in a little bit quicker time.
Well, surgery went well with Miss Denise. She's out of surgery. She's recovering in the ICU right now. So just keep praying for her and that long road of recovery. They didn't have to take out as much as they thought, so praise the Lord for that. Just continue to pray for the family. Hospital bills coming up, you know how those can be. So pray for finances with that, and just pray for the whole family as they get, you know, ready as we, you know, get ready to start the TET meeting. I'm sure that's going to be kind of rough for them. Pray, keep praying for Brother Nate. I haven't heard an update. I don't know if you have, Brother Hewitt. Yes, sir.
His memory will start clicking back. But I mean, I think he's going to be okay. It's just a long road.
Right.
I mean,
yes, sir.
He broke, they did find out he broke a vertebrae.
He did.
So that's
okay.
A big deal too. So
yes, sir.
It's going to be, they're going to have to let swelling go down and stuff.
Right.
Do you know if the Wilsons have any kind of insurance?
I believe so, but I'm not sure. So.
I'll ask you that.
Okay. Right. So let's keep praying for Brother Nate and that. Get his memory back, because I know that can be a big thing. So let's keep praying for him. Keep praying for our missionaries. Pray, as I say this afternoon, the Schraders in Zambia are getting ready to start their VBS this week. So pray for that. I know that's a real big deal. They're trying to get all those kids involved. And I know even as little kids as they got, those kids want to get involved in the ministry. So pray for them as they get that VBS started, that they'll be able to see souls saved. I know it's kind of a rough road for Brother Schrader. There's a lot of people that'll go over to Africa and they'll try to do this 1, 2, 3, repeat after me type of thing and so-called see souls saved. But Brother Schrader really tries to deal with people for a long time, helping them understand that it's not about works, it's not about a prayer that you pray, but it's about personally having that personal relationship with Jesus Christ. So let's pray for them and that ministry, and pray for Brother Daniel Freed. And as their RV has broke down, that he'll need a new engine. Pray for him. And pray for the rest of the TET team as they travel in and everything as we get ready for the work week this week for the TET. Pray for physical safety as people are going and walking streets and hanging bags on doors and talking to people. Pray for spiritual strength as people will be able to give the gospel to people and have the right words to say and exactly what the Lord would have them to be able to see souls saved. Pray for Brother Hewitt as he preaches tonight, and then also as he preaches for the 2 weeks of the TET meeting, and if the Lord wills, possible more. Pray for his voice, and I pray for everything involved in the TET meeting that the Lord have his way and will in that. Let's go ahead and have the children's offering now. I have all the kids come up.
Everything.
Amen. Let's go ahead and stand once again. Turn to page number 420 in the Great Songbook. 420, He Keeps Me Singing. Page number 420. For our last song here, 447, The Haven of Rest. 447, The Haven of Rest. Sing it out.
My soul in sad exile was out on life's sea, so burdened with sin and distress, till I heard a sweet voice say, make your choice. Secure in the haven.
come up and sing.
When I look around and see the good things He's done for me, I know I'm unworthy of them all. For His blessings He freely gives, I owe my whole life to Him. I've got so much to thank Him for.
Our privilege to have Brother Chris Hewitt preaching again tonight. He wasn't supposed to preach tonight. Pastor was supposed to be here, but we're thankful that Brother Hewitt can be in season and out of season, and we're thankful for him to be able to preach. Brother, come on and preach for us.
Hey, amen. It's good to be saved tonight, and JP, you're going to just have to learn how to run, brother. You don't need one of them moving sidewalks. You just need to learn how to hustle. I'm just picking, by the way. I purposely walk around those things in the airport because I don't want people to think I'm lazy. And y'all say amen or something. Smile. And it's kind of cool for Buddy, though, in that chair to ride on. That's pretty cool. The other day, we didn't really have time to get on the elevator. We were in between flights, and I don't know what they thought. They probably thought the Clampets were coming to Atlanta or something, but I put his chair on the escalator. Y'all don't turn me in or nothing. But we rode up that escalator with his chair and rode down that escalator with his chair, and he was having a time, wouldn't you, buddy? So we didn't have time to wait on the elevator. Let's go back to Matthew 17 tonight, and looking forward to what the Lord has for us tonight. Again, did not expect to preach this today, and then wasn't expecting necessarily to preach tonight, and looking forward for the opportunity. And we're praying for all these needs. And obviously, I believe in, and I'm on the pastor's group. We have a pastor's group, polo, whatever you want to call it. There in the we talk and share burdens, and just seems like this year has been more fight in the churches, like just hurt, just things happening, just crazy stuff. And Brother Randall Morris has been going through just a trial of a lifetime the last year, and different people in different churches going through things. And then today, I've been afraid to pick up my phone, Brother Ben. You know, I've gotten two big phone calls today, and I don't know what the Lord wants to do, but Brother Samuel Freed and I were talking about it on the way to church, and he's got so much wisdom. And he said, you know, Brother Chris, we as humans, we get in the habit of getting into a routine. He said, this is our fifth year in this meeting. He said, it'd be real easy to get into a routine and think we know how to do it and go right into it and try to do it on our own. And he said, maybe the Lord is allowing some of these things to fall out on us to remind us we can't do it on our own. And so that was a lot of wisdom in that. So let's lean on Him in the days to come. And you pray for me. Brother JP mentioned it. My voice, that my mind would stay right. I've got a lot of things going on. More people coming from out of town in this year than we've ever had. We've got the School of Evangelism. So literally that whole week I will be teaching a class just about every morning on a subject for 6 days. And I won't be doing the outreach in the afternoons during that time. But interns, being prepared, being ready, no telling what may come up. And that's a lot of weight. And the Bible says, Jesus said, without me you can do nothing. And you may hear me repeat that a lot. I do. I use that verse a lot, Brother Ben, because without Him I can do nothing. I am useless without Him. So would you pray for me physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, all of these things, and that God would guide me in the exact message to preach every single night. I understand. I asked Brother JP this morning. I said, Brother JP, have you ever heard me preach that? And he said, Brother Hewitt, I can just be honest with you. I've heard you preach so much, I can't remember what you preached. And what a blessing, you know, JP is to me, an encouragement. Thank you, JP. No, but in all seriousness, there's no group of people that's heard me preach more. And that's intimidating. I want to be fresh. I can't do this without God. And so I ask you to pray for us. Matthew 17. Would y'all allow me to finish the message I started this morning? And dive back into that. Let's just read these verses again to get it familiar on our heart again. Matthew 17, verse 1. And after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into an high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as the light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elias, talking with them. And then answered Peter, and said unto Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make here three tabernacles, one for thee, and one for Moses, and one for Elias. While he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud, which said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased, hear ye him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their face, and were sore afraid. And Jesus came, and touched them, and said, arise, and be not afraid. And when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man, save Jesus only. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day, dear Lord. I thank you for all you've done for us today. Thank you, dear God, for touching Sister Denise today. As Brother Samuel and I were talking earlier, we could have lost two dear friends today, Lord. We could have lost Sister Denise. We could have easily lost Brother Nate. It could have been a lot different day today, Lord. And Lord, we thank you, dear God. We want to thank you right now, Lord, that you protected our friends. Lord, that you touched them, that you've given them doctors to help them. And Lord, we bless your name for that. Lord, we pray, dear God, that you build a hedge of protection around those involved in the meeting going forward. I pray, dear God, Lord, you know our frame. You know how much we can handle. You know, Lord, that we are dependent upon you. Help us not to get into a rut, dear God, or get into just a going through the motions. But Lord, that you would meet us in power and in grace and in mercy in the upcoming days. Lord, we cannot do it without you. I pray that you fill me tonight, use me, bring to remembrance those things that we've studied, and use this message in the hearts of your people tonight. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Thank you. Might be seated tonight. Everybody here, it was here this morning. Is that correct? Was anybody not here this morning? All right. So I am going to say very little about what I said this morning. I believe we proved our case through the scriptures of what Jesus had brought them there for, and he is showing his deity and his magnificence to these disciples that he has brought up on the mountain, and it was just for them. And we talked about how if we're not careful, we can allow saints, even godly saints, even great saints in our life to hinder us from seeing and getting what Jesus has for us. That's very easy, and I hope you thought on that today. I hope you meditated on that today. And it is. It's very easy. It's just one little glimpse of something or thought of something. It's very easy to get our hearts and minds off of Jesus and on others. And so tonight, we stopped in verse 4 this morning with silliness. And the thought this morning, and Brother JP came and asked me what my title was. I never really got to it. But the thought, the message is going from silliness to seeing no man save Jesus only. My mentor, Brother Stennett Blue, used to say, never just hang people out over hell and not give them an out with the gospel. And never just preach the devil out of somebody and not tell them how to get it right. And I believe we were discussing things this morning. We walked through things this morning. But here in the text, Jesus shows how these men went from looking at the saints to just seeing Jesus. And I want to look at this tonight and make a little application, if we can, and then we'll go home. So it's going from silliness to seeing no man save Jesus only. The first thing, if we're going to get to seeing no man save Jesus only, there's going to have to be a lingering in our lives. In verse number 5, the Bible says, while he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And we discussed this morning dispensations just very briefly, but we understand we're in the book of Matthew, but they are living under the old covenant here. And in this verse, it talks about that cloud. And if you go back to Numbers, there is a cloud there as well. Y'all remember the cloud in the Old Testament? And you had the children of Israel in the provocation, and it was just amazing. Could you imagine? This isn't a little rain cloud on Bugs Bunny that always rained on Elmer Fudd. Can I get an amen? That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about at least 2 million Jews, Brother Ben, in a wide open wilderness, a desert. And Brother JP, that cloud covered them. And that cloud represented the presence of God. Is that right? When the tabernacle needed to move, the cloud moved. So that presence of God, that manifestation of God, was represented there on the tabernacle. It was protection for them. Could you imagine the sunburn? I had been down around Jerusalem. I've been out by the Dead Sea. I've seen Masada and places like that. And it is a barren wasteland. Could you imagine living there for 40 years? And listen, I have to believe a God that didn't let their shoes wear out for 40 years. I believe he's probably the same kind of God that could keep them from getting sunburned every day for 40 years. You say, I don't believe that. Well, this is for believers only. I'm preaching right now. You can preach it different when you get to preach. Amen? But there's a cloud in the sky. God is covering his people. If you think about it, it's a representation of the presence of God. It's a representation of the protection of God. I'll tell you what else it is. It is a protection. It is a representation of the direction of God. This is, and I'm not being irreverent, but this is really GPS here. If they needed to go to the left, that's where the cloud went. If they needed to go to the right, that's where the cloud went. This is where their provision came from. Brother Ben, every day we know this, that out of that cloud came manna and came rotisserie quail. So biscuits and quail, hallelujah, every day. So, Brother Chris, what are you talking about? I'm telling you that every day they could walk out of their tent for 40 years and look up in the sky and see a physical proof and representation of everything God was to them. Isn't that amazing? It was the Spirit of God moving. It was. That cloud in the Old Testament, when Moses went in Exodus 33 and that cloud filled the temple. When, Solomon, he built the temple and it was finished and the priest could not minister because of what? The cloud. That is the representation of the Spirit of God. And follow me here. You've got the Trinity meeting on this mountain. You've got God the Son there physically. You got God the Spirit manifesting Himself through a cloud, and you've got God the Father speaking. You have the Trinity, all three separate, all three one. I'm trying not to dive into that. Woo! So what, follow me here. This cloud, they're still living in that dispensation. So when that cloud shows up, it's literal, Brother JP, but it is the Spirit of God working on that thing. And you know what? The best thing that could ever happen to us is to get to the point in our lives where the Holy Ghost, and I'm not being charismatic with this, I'm not being sensational with this, but when the Holy Ghost saturates every part of our life, when our services are saturated by the Holy Ghost, when our lives are saturated by the Holy Ghost, where our prayer time, our preaching, our witnessing, our child raising, our marriage, our home life, our work life, everything we do is permeated by the Holy Ghost of God. Because here's the truth of the matter. I like this. Brother Josh, it wasn't but one person shining on that mountain. And when the cloud showed up, they had a really hard time seeing James. They really had a hard time seeing John and Peter. They had a hard time seeing Moses and Elijah. But there was one person that they did not have a hard time seeing. And guess who that was? His name is Jesus. Amen. And I'm going to tell you, I'm making application here. But when the power and presence of God shows up in our lives, when we are walking in the light and His presence is real, I'll tell you what we see. We see Jesus. It is the job of the Holy Ghost of God to point us to Him. Amen. I remember growing up, I was before I was saved, and my great-grandfather lived behind my grandparents in Hiram, Georgia. He had a little one-room shack built onto like a 1970s pull-behind trailer camper, and a very poor man. He was a sharecropper and a blacksmith by trade. That's all he knew how to do, could not write. Could barely read, very, very little could he read. And Brother Ben, he had a screen door that had more hole than screen in it. It was one of them that slammed behind you. Y'all know with the little spring. I like that sound. You know, everybody knows you're there. But I remember as a young child, and I guess the reason this instance sticks out to me, it's probably the first time I ever really noticed the presence of God, and it wasn't even in church. I walked over there. We had another deacon. My great-grandfather was a deacon at the church I grew up at. And we had another deacon named Russell Aston. And my paw would just praise God. Brother Russell, though, he was a weeper. He just wept. I mean, you could whisper Jesus in the foyer, and Brother Russell was going to weep. I loved it. I loved that I got to grow up around people like that. And I walked over, and Pawpaw didn't have two nickels to rub together. And Miss Jenny, he was feeble by this time. This was the mid-90s. He was just a few years away from death. I walked over. I couldn't have been but 5 or 6 years old. I walked into that screen door that day, through that screen door, into that one-room shack. And my pawpaw had a Magnavox television set, and he called it a VRC. That's how bad he couldn't read. He couldn't tell you it was a VCR. He called it a VRC. Some of y'all have no idea. Ask your parents when you get home. But he had a video of the McCameys singing from 1988, the first time Peg ever sang God on the Mountain live. And they were in there watching that. And Brother Ben, I know it wasn't the first time they've ever watched it. But man, it was like walking into some, I mean, you could just feel, and I ain't being spooky tonight, but I walked into the presence of God. It was the first time as a child I ever recognized there's something more than my pawpaw and Brother Russell in this room. Brother JP, I walked in and pawpaw, he had a big old Bible that was made in the early 1900s. And he would sit there and cry and rub the pages of the Bible, and it had tear stains. My dad still got the Bible. It's thicker and all get out because of the tear stains. And pawpaw was sitting there and he was rubbing his Bible. Brother Russell was just sitting there, just had his hands up, just a squalling. And I walked by Brother Russell and pawpaw said, "Come on over here, Chris." And he put me in his lap. And in that moment, Miss Carlene, he began to pray over me that God would save me and that God would use me. And I mean this, y'all. I didn't get saved for at least another 5 or 6 years, but I know the presence of God was real that day. And I'm thankful that's my first memory of it, but I'm thankful it's not my last memory of it. I have experienced God, and you may not have any idea what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about anything sensational or charismatic, but God made us emotional creatures, and God, just like He walked with Adam in the cool of the day, and Adam knew the presence of God, God wants you and I to know the presence of God. If you're saved tonight, you're indwelt with the Holy Ghost. Amen. He owns you. You are bought with a price. He indwells you. But there is a difference in the indwelling presence of God and the manifested presence of God. And what we're missing in our churches, what we're missing in our marriages, what we're missing in our prayer lives, what we're missing in our homes, what we're missing in our preaching, what we're missing in our Bible time, and what we're missing at the workplace, you name it. We need the presence of God every day of our life. And we have got so much figured out, but we're missing so much. Granny, my pawpaw couldn't even read. But he knew what it was to walk and live in the presence of God. And I'm not belittling education. Y'all hear me? Me and Brother Ben talk about education. I love his intellect. I love what he teaches and how he teaches. I'm not belittling education. But maybe we've learned so much that we've forgotten something. And it's the main thing. See, you can, and I mentioned it earlier, what Brother Samuel was talking about. But we can have all our T's crossed and our I's dotted, and we can have everything just right. But if we go into these next few weeks without the cloud, for lack of a better term, without the presence of God, nobody's going to see Jesus. See, when the cloud came on this mountain, it blotted out everybody else. It hid everybody else. And Brother JP, I mentioned it this morning, but people don't need to see me. They don't need to see you. And listen, I have those pastors sit behind me as accountability, as authority, and as unity on that platform. But you hear me, nobody needs to see those pastors. Nobody needs to see the singers. I'll tell you who people need to see in our lives and in the tent meeting and in our churches, in our homes. They need to see Jesus. You ever just met an old saint of God that the Lord just rested on their lives and you couldn't help but see Jesus? Amen. I get intimidated being around Brother Samuel sometimes, and he ain't here, so I can brag on him all I want to. But Brother Ben, I'm telling you, that man walks with God. That man knows the presence of God. And I love being around him because I don't see Samuel free. I see Jesus. Amen. Does anybody see Jesus in you? I understand I'm using the terminology in the text, but we understand the presence of God. Does the presence of God rest in your life? Do you know anything about what I'm talking about tonight? Has there ever been a time you just got away with God and you walked with God privately and you stayed, you didn't rush, you didn't worry, you just got away with God. You started worshiping God. I'm going to tell you, there's been times, Brother Josh, I've had to pull over on the side of the road because I get the case of the can't help it, and it's dangerous to drive under that kind of influence. I'll get to crying, I'll get to weeping, I'll get to worshiping God. It's dangerous, amen. And you understand I'm being a little bit comical there, but I'm telling you, there's been times I've had to pull over my car because the presence of God was surreal. Have you ever experienced that? Again, it's not, you don't have to wait till you're 40. You don't have to wait till you're gray-headed with a walking cane. You can experience God like that right now. My little boy, and y'all know this, he made a profession of faith in the tent meeting this year in May. And he's six now. And yesterday I watched him give a track out to an African man, got in his wheelchair, you know, rolled up, made me so proud. But Brother Ben, I have to believe that if my little boy can understand about salvation, and my little boy can understand the gravity of the Great Commission and begin to witness to people. Granny, I believe with all my heart that God can meet with that boy right there just like he meets with the man and you. You do not have to wait till you're old to know God. So we need a lingering. We need the presence of God again. Number two, there was a listening. Look at verse 5 again. While he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. Again, it's all of this is pointing us to Jesus. The cloud's here, so now nobody else can be seen. Number two, there's a listening. And behold, a voice out of the cloud. Isn't it amazing? When the cloud shows up, the Word of God shows up. It gives a new gravity to the Word of God when the cloud is present. Which said, "This is my beloved Son, and whom I am well pleased, hear ye him." There are three times in the Gospels that we know of, and again, John said everything couldn't be put in a book. But we know it at the baptism of Jesus. God almost says the exact same thing. And by the way, I know Peter could have been there. Amen. Those disciples could have been there right there that day when a lot of them could have been there. Watch this. So they hear him at the baptism of Jesus. And then in John 12, and it's so different because John's different. But in John 12, God speaks from heaven to Jesus. But you hear me, this is very common of what God, it was very consistent of what God said while Jesus was here on earth. And it's three part. "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased, hear ye him." And I got to thinking, when the Word of God, and we need that today, And you better be thankful you got that here. You better be thankful you got that here. We go to places sometimes and pray to God. Are we live tonight? Here we go. About to lose some meetings. Amen. I'm not naming any names. I'm not telling years or dates. But we've been to some places where it's nothing more than story time. And you understand, I just told a story. But this morning, I preached for maybe 45 minutes and didn't mention a story. It's just the Bible. Tonight, I'm going to give you much Bible. You understand? I'm not against using a story. Jesus used stories. But that's not all our preaching needs to be. Our life experience. Because I'll tell you this, my life is eventually, I'm going to run out of experiences. But I got 66 books here that's fresh and new every time I look at it. And if I'll just preach, I'm getting ahead of myself. If I'll just preach the book, we won't have to worry about none of it. I see this every time the Word, and this is the Word of God. Is it not? He said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." That I understand this is the Word of God, but literally, those words, that is the Word of God. Right? So we need a listening. We need to get back to the book. The Word of God will always do three things. It will point us to Jesus, but it will point us to these things about Jesus. Number one, it confirms the Word of God when it's preached in its context. Rightly divided, with the right spirit, it will always confirm who Jesus is. "This is my beloved Son." God could have said anything, Brother Josh. God could have proclaimed anything. He's God. But when the heavens opened up on this mountain and God's trying to teach these young men some things, he said, "You listen here, young men. He is who he says he is. This is my beloved Son." He confirms who Jesus is. Number two, every time the Word of God's preached in its context, rightly divided, I'm talking about in the right spirit, because you can preach the right thing with the wrong spirit and do damage. And the second thing it's going to always do, it's going to commend Jesus. "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." These young men are questioning. Remember in chapter 16, Peter rebukes Jesus? He just gave Peter the keys to the kingdom, and now he's telling Peter he's a devil because Peter rebuked Jesus for saying he was going to be crucified. God says, I'm pleased with everything he's doing. God, Brother Ben, God could have said anything here. But he says, he's my son. That's exactly who he is. I'm telling you, boys, he's my boy. But not only that, I'm going to lift him up. Because God has given him a name above what? Every name. That verse in Philippians had not been written yet by Paul, but it was already in the mind of God. God has given him a name that is above what? Every name. God, when he got a chance to say something on behalf of his son, he didn't try to correct anything. He didn't try to put anything in order. He said, that's my boy. He's exactly who he says he is. But let me tell you that. I'm going to just lift him up for a second. Every time the word of God's preached, that's what it ought to do. Number three. It's right here in the text. Y'all see this? This is how we're going to see Jesus. This kind of preaching. This kind of preaching where the Word of God tells us who Jesus is, it lifts Jesus up. But number three, watch it. I love this. Hear ye Him. Wait a minute. What did Jesus just say to these guys? If any man come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, follow me. What did Jesus just say in the previous chapter? If any man shall keep his life, he will lose it. But if any man lose his life, he gets to keep it. Y'all get what I'm saying here? This, the hardest thing Jesus ever says to them, the next chapter, God says, hey, he is who he says he is. I'm going to lift him up. I love him. But not only that, you need to, he commands them to follow him. Whatever he says for you to do, you do it. Hear him. Live what he says. And I don't care, Brother JP, if we're preaching on tithing or giving or marriage or modesty or the doctrines of the Word of God or salvation, whatever it is, if it's preached in its context, rightly divided with the right spirit, it's always going to commend him. It's going to confirm who he is, and it's going to command us to do what he's telling us to do. If ye love me, keep my commandments. So tonight, we need a lingering. We need a listening. We need the Word of God. You need the Word of God in your life. So instead of listening to talk radio or what have you, turn on Alexander Scorby. I'm going to tell y'all, there is a treasure trove, and I'm not talking about goofy people on YouTube. I'm talking about there is a treasure trove of men of God, like-minded, like we are, on sermon audio. Y'all have sermon audio account, Brother JP, on YouTube, on podcasts. Go, hey, if you want a list, go come talk to me. If you want some more, go talk to your pastor. My pastor's got over 1,000 messages on YouTube or on podcasts. Man, go listen to these Bible preachers, all right? You need to grow in that. I remember a couple of years ago, I think I've told you this before, Brother Ben, I used to listen to Ben Shapiro every day when I was working out. But now he's got such a filthy mouth, you can't listen to him. But I used to listen to him every day because he just give it to the liberals. I love it. But I found myself around the middle of 2019 like being really anxious. And that's not how I am. Sister Carlene, I'm not like that. But I got to thinking, and I started noticing that politics, and I'm not against preaching on politics. I think we ought to be involved in, but I started noticing that every message I preached, there was my political views coming out. And Brother Ben, let's just be honest. If somebody our age that's not of like mind of us starts to hear me preach on that all the time, they ain't going to have nothing to do with what I got to say about Jesus. And I traced it back. I thought, oh, no. Because of what I'm putting into me, it's coming out of me. There is a very well-known preacher that when I was younger, I listened to him religiously. And I just, being quite honest, he was a smart aleck. And here I was in my early 20s, echoing what a man in his late 40s was saying, and he was wrong for saying it, but it sounds a lot worse when it's coming from a 21-year-old. And Brother Nate, I started hearing Brother Ballou always told me to listen to my preaching every once in a while, and I heard a jerk. Me. You know why? Because I was all I was putting in me. Y'all listening to me tonight? What are you putting in you? Because whatever, the Word of God is going to be preached from your life. It's preached from the pulpit, but it's preached from your life. We are epistles seen and read of all men. So this evening, what are you putting in you? What is in the well comes up in the bucket. What is down in the well this evening? And listen, you need a good, healthy diet of the Word of God, because if you don't, you are going to be consumed and just tore up if all you ever do is watch Fox News or OAN or whatever it's whatever people are watching now. You're going to go crazy. But if you get in this book, you're going to see Jesus. I see the listening. I see the lingering. Number three, I see a lowering. And listen, I'm making application. Y'all are being very gracious. I understand I'm making application here. I understand what's happening in the text. Verse 6, and when the disciples heard it, they fell on their face and were sore afraid. Now, I want everybody to watch me. This is very deep. Y'all are going to miss this if you don't watch. Watch this. Brother JP, I cannot see you from this position. I can't see Brother Ben. I can't see Granny. I can't even, when I'm down here, I can't even see my wife. Lowering. See, they had the right posture, didn't they? We've already talked about walking and living in the presence of God. We've already talked about the Word of God. But now, what about prayer? What about a prayer life? What about getting on your face? See, I have a really hard time talking about people when I'm praying for them. I'm going to say that again. I have a really hard time. Am I dead, fellas? I am dead. This is dead. I
must have hit it.
There it is. Man, I ain't never done like that before. Sorry. Maybe God just didn't want us to hear the rest of that. Amen? Nah. You have a hard time talking about people that you're praying for. I've never met a man that prayed for a couple, you know, a good while in the morning that went out and committed.
Am I right? You don't, and listen, they may say they are, but I just don't believe that men that are praying in the Holy Ghost go out and do that now. Brother Nate, I'll be honest with you, I think in any day, it wasn't me, JP. You hear me? It wasn't me. Y'all bear with us. Technical, you know, you can't preach without a lapel. It's not possible. You know, you could have hung around that, turned it on for you. Man, mate. No, I'm just kidding, mate. Thank you. Let me get all hooked up. All right. There we go. Can you hear me?
Hello, Tokyo. All right, there we go. So, again, a prideful man isn't a praying man. And a praying man isn't a prideful man. The biggest enemy of pride is prayer. And again, I can't focus on all of you when I'm laying before God and God's showing me how wicked I am. This Jesus on this mountain pressed these young men down. These men took a posture of prayer here, and I believe we need to take the same posture. I would ask you this evening, how is your prayer life? How is your time with the Lord? See, I've said this for years. If you don't make time, you never will have time. You just won't. If you don't make time, if you don't take time and make time, you will never have time to pray. It has to be the most important thing that we do. And listen, am I an expert at it? Absolutely not. But I've had to learn how to pray going down the road. Granny, I've had to learn how to, I live in a camper. Can I just be honest with y'all? A lot of times my shower is my prayer closet because that's the only time I get to be alone. Amen. I've had to, you catch Brother Samuel. Brother Samuel, I've called him in between air conditioned units outside so he could hide from everybody and pray. I want to live my life like that. I don't need less prayer. I need more prayer. Here's the issue. We focus so much on the platform time. We focus so much on what people see because we would be embarrassed, Brother Ben, if we didn't have something to say. But I'm more embarrassed when I don't have something behind what I'm saying. Did y'all catch that? We see Jesus better when we're on our knees. I see the lingering. I see the listening. I see the lowering. And let me say this. If you don't have a prayer list, you probably don't have a prayer life. I struggled with this, Brother Ben, for years. Once I left the youth, when I was youth pastor and I went and I was assistant for my dad, I would pray around the church building because we don't have assigned seats, but we might as well, right? We sit where we sit, okay? And my dad at that time, they were running around 125 to 150, somewhere around there, Brother Ben. Very wide church. The farthest, the back wall is only 35 foot from the pulpit, but it's very wide. It's a 70 foot wide building, and they've got fanned seating. And Brother JP, I would sit there and I would pray every day, and I could name every, I would go up and down. Y'all get what I'm saying? I would go up and down the pews in my mind, and I could pray that way. So did I have that wrote out? No, but I had it in my mind. And when I left that position at my dad's church and I went on the road, I'll just be honest with you, I had a hard time keeping a consistent prayer life because I wasn't involved in those same people's lives every day. Y'all get what I'm saying? So you have to find things to pray about. Here's a good thing. That would make a good list. What a novel idea. That would make a good prayer. I'm on the bottom row there, my family and I. That would make a good list. Pray for me if you ain't got nothing better to pray for. Pray for JP. He needs a lot of prayer. But my point is, we're so selfish in our praying. And if you're selfish in your praying, you won't have much to pray for. When it's just about me, Miss Carlene, I have a hard time praying. But when it's about others, not in criticism, but in a burden, man, that's when prayer is going to open up for you. I'm spending too much time. Y'all pray for me. I'm trying to be sensitive to the Lord. Fourth thing, if we're going to go from silliness to seeing no man save Jesus only, there's going to have to be a longing. Man, I love this part. And Jesus came and touched them and said, "Arise, be not afraid." These three men, can I say it like this, had the touch of God on them. It's right there. It literally is right there. They had the touch of God on them. And I understand we're using that as an application. Y'all understand that as well. We have that terminology, somebody that has the touch of God on their lives. We see that. They don't go around telling everybody, but it's obvious in their life. And I got to thinking, John was a young man here, maybe a teenager. He watched everybody else get to go off and turn the world upside down. Brother Ben, think about John in this aspect. He's a young preacher, and here he's the only one at the cross, out of all the disciples, he's the only male at the cross, the only man at the cross, out of the disciples. He's the disciple whom what? Jesus loved. I mean, what a title. Everybody else in John 13 that says, "Is it I, Lord? Is it I?" John's laying on his bosom. He said, "Who is it?" See, when you're that close to God, you don't have to say, "Is it I?" You get to say, "Who is it?" And here's John. He's given everything. It seems like I'm giving him the keys. Right? Can I get an amen? Peter's got foot and mouth syndrome. Judas is about to betray him. All the others are, you know, they're not out front, but John has got it going. He beats Peter in a foot race to the tomb. He's even more athletic, okay? Can we put it that way? Well, Brother Josh, Jesus doesn't give him the keys. I mean, Peter was he was fishing naked after the resurrection. He's already seen the resurrected Jesus, and he's out there on his boat fishing naked. That's a Baptist preacher for you, all right? I'm kidding. He's cussing at the trial. What a winner. He ain't the one I'm picking. I'm picking John. John gets a nursing home ministry. He said, you see that letter? Behold thy mother. And other than Acts 3, we know he's in Acts 2 because Peter stood up with the 11, right? By the way, the Holy Ghost counting Matthias, but that's a whole other message. Sorry. And then we get to Acts 6, and it says with the 11. So we understand he's there. But Brother Ben, he has no prominence. Acts 3, we see him at the temple, but it's Peter doing. Peter's the one out front. And here's John, who has been the most consistent. Here's John, the disciple who Jesus loved. Here's John that laid on the bosom of Jesus. Here is John that Jesus trusted his own mother to. And Jesus had other brothers. And he said, nope, I don't trust all them. I trust John. Watch this. And everybody else is going around turning the world upside down. Everybody else, here comes Paul. He's been killing all of us. And instead of John getting that job, Paul gets it. But it's like John had blinders on. His friends are getting martyred. He just keeps going for God. Everybody else is writing the Bible. John just keeps on going. By the way, his gospel is the last gospel to be written. Book of Revelation, last book to be written. Granny, he's not getting the limelight. He's not getting the platform. He's not getting his name on the page. Why does he keep going? Because he had the touch of God on his life. He had a longing in his life. As a young man, God put his hand on his life. God gave him a special ministry. God used him as a young man, and God put that hand on him. God led him through his midlife. God led him through into old age, and now he's an old preacher. Now listen, he's been preaching all those years, and history tells us he was about 90 years old. He's pastoring. Can you imagine the message he preached that day as a 90-year-old man that made him want to boil him in oil? I mean, that's ripping it up, son. Can you imagine him up, Brother JP, he walks up that day, all right, turning your Bible. You know, he's like ripping the hide off. And they boil him in oil, and it doesn't kill him. What a tough old dude. And they exile him. Oh, I love this part. In Revelation 1, he's in the Spirit on the Sabbath. Nope. He's a Spirit on the Lord's Day. He's in the Spirit on the Lord's Day, and he's an old, worn out, beat up, exiled preacher. No fanfare, Granny. No lights. No big pages on the book of Acts. But here's an old preacher. And he's in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. And all of a sudden, he hears a voice behind him. Y'all remember who that was, right? John recognized the voice. And as he turned around, there was Jesus. And what was Jesus doing? He was glowing again. And what did John do? The same thing he did as a young preacher, he did as an old preacher. When the presence of God was real, when Jesus was in his purview, he got down real low. And what did God do for the old preacher? The same thing he did for the young preacher. He put his hand on him. I'm going to tell you tonight, I'm not being goofy, but we are missing the hand of God on our lives. It's good for the young. It's good for the old. I don't know how long I've been preaching. I'm sorry, everybody. I went to Papua New Guinea in 2019. I was in the jungle, or up in the mountains, excuse me. We're not in the jungle that time. We were up in the bush. And very primitive. We didn't have running water. We were using an outhouse. We were no electricity. They had a solar system, and we could charge some things, but there was over 1,000 nationals sleeping on the church property on the ground. A large groups had walked for 2 days sleeping in the ditch to get there because there's no hotels in the bush. They're eating potatoes. They're getting like a ration of 2 potatoes a day. They're killing like lambs and pigs for us. Poor Brother Samuel. I ate his portion. Don't worry, everybody. Brother JP, I'll never forget, they had a, up on the mountain behind the church property, they had a rock altar. And there's somebody back there at the door, Nate, or somebody. I don't know where Nate went. He must be out smoking. I'm just kidding. He's not out smoking, everybody. But we here we were, and they had that rock altar up behind the church. And I thought, well, I'll get up every morning, Brother Ben, when I'm there, my body clock, it just clicks on. I get up about 4 o'clock every morning. And I was getting up consistently at 4 o'clock, and I wanted to go up to that rock altar. And I go up there, Brother JP, the first morning, Monday morning, and I cannot get to the top of the altar or to the top of the hill where the altar's at. There are nationals laid out all over the altar, or all over that top of that mountain. I could not get up the trail. So Tuesday morning, it's raining. I'm sitting in this little grass hut where they had a solar light in there, and I could study and pray. And I didn't go up to the mountain that day. And at about 6 a.m., or a little before 6, I started seeing shadows moving out there in the darkness. And I go, and I'm watching. And I asked Brother Holmes, I'm like, what's going on? He said, they're just getting ready. And I'm thinking, getting ready? Service isn't until 9 o'clock. And at 6 o'clock that morning, these people had been sleeping on the ground, going to eat 2 potatoes that day, didn't have nothing to their name. Most of them barefoot, Miss Carlene. And they're not living in poverty. They have what they need. But here's what happened. At 6 o'clock, I heard, 1, 2, 3. There's 1,000 PNG people up in the tent while we're still supposed to be in bed. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore by and by. Brother Ben, I'll just be honest. I was convicted. They were having pre-church for church all day. Miss Carlene, I walked out in the rain that day. I went live because I wanted everybody to see it. I wanted everybody to hear it. But I asked the Lord that day, I said, Lord, what do these people have that we don't? Because here's you know who they learned that from? Americans. They learned to act like that from our people, and we don't act like that anymore. And I said, Lord, what do they have that we don't? Look, God didn't speak to me, Cruz, and nothing like that. I'm just saying the Spirit of God dealt with my heart. They have nothing. They have nothing, and we have everything. And because we have everything, we have nothing. And because they have nothing, they have everything. I'll tell you what we're missing. We're missing the touch of God, the hand of God, the presence of God on our lives. I'll be the first one to admit it. Last thing tonight. There's a looking. I know it's very deep, but there's a looking. Verse 8, when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man save Jesus only. Just start looking for him. If you'll start looking for Jesus, he's real easy to spot. He's the only one that ought to be shining in our life. There needs to be a lingering. We need that presence of God corporately. We need that listening. We need the Word of God. We need the lowering. We need prayer back in our lives. We need that longing for His touch once again. But we just need to look. That's how you're going to go from looking at saints and the silliness of focusing on saints all the time and what everybody's doing right or what everybody's doing wrong. And boy, don't we have an opportunity for that today with social media. I had to get off of Instagram, Sister Carlene, a couple of years ago. I was using it for the ministry. I didn't have it because I wanted to show everybody my recipes, all right? I was using it for the ministry. But can I just be honest with you? I got tired of seeing Baptist preachers' wives with no clothes on. And I thought, these men call me to preach, and they expect me not to say nothing about that. And I'm of the persuasion, if you're bold enough to preach, post it, I ought to be bold enough to preach against it. But anyways, I just had to get off of it. I've had to back off of my scrolling because I see people and they claim all this stuff and they think you can just throw the baby out with the bathwater and you don't have to have any standard, any conviction, any principle anymore. And I can get so focused on those people, Brother Ben, that I get bitter about the very thing God has me doing. It's real, isn't it? Oh, nobody's doing it right anymore. And if you're not careful, if you watch people long enough, they'll be your out. You'll use them as your excuse to leave this way because of people. Brother Sammy used to say, I've quoted him four times today, Brother Sammy used to say, nobody becomes a Calvinist by reading the Bible. They become a Calvinist by reading books. And you don't become You don't become a libertine. I'm going to say it that way. You don't become a libertine by watching Jesus. You become a libertine by watching people. You don't become a rebel by watching Jesus. You become a rebel by watching people. You don't become ecumenical by watching Jesus. You become ecumenical by watching people. You don't become bitter by watching Jesus. You become bitter by watching people. Again, I said it this morning. He never changes. And if you want consistency in your Christian life, if you want consistency in your walk with God, you have got to get to looking at Jesus. It's the only way. It's the only way. Miss Carlene, you care if I play the altar call tonight? I'm going to play the altar call.
Try to imagine the great love of God, then try to imagine how far He would come, then stop to remember the price that He paid. I traded worthless old rags for a garment of grace. From rags to royalty, my life's not the same. From rags to redemption, the Savior took my place. From rags to great riches, heaven's now mine. Just try to imagine as we walk through the gates, then try to imagine as we look on His face. No pain, no more heartaches, no burdens to bear, but what may in heaven, Jesus is there. From rags to royalty, my life's not the same. From rags to redemption, the Savior took my place. From rags to great riches, heaven's now mine to claim. I traded rags for the Savior's blood. Now I know that I'm saved. From rags for the Savior's blood. Now I know that.